Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And welcome to historic 4th Street United Methodist Church in downtown Lynchburg. It's so good to be in worship with each one of you this morning, and I hope you get a blessing from our worship today. A few announcements for you. Our Sunday school class will be immediately following the service today. That will be in the Wesley Gill Room, which is all the way at the other end of the church. And the lesson for today is Too Good to Be True. Also, the LU Concert Choir will be here next Sunday. John Hugo and the choir will join us for worship at 9:30 next Sunday morning. So we're all looking forward to that. Also, the LU Honored String Quartet will be here on Sunday, May the 7th. So mark your calendars for that. That's at 1 p.m. in the sanctuary. That's May the 7th. Would you stand with me now for our call to worship? Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Our opening hymn is In the Garden, number 314 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
Let us now pray together our prayer of the people. O Lord, your wondrous birth means nothing unless we're born again. Your death and sacrifice mean nothing unless we die to sin. Your resurrection means nothing if you be risen alone. Raise and exalt us, O Savior, both now to the estate of grace and hereafter to the state of glory, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, God forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Holy and loving God, you treat us not like the stern disciplinary, but like the forgiving parent who runs to embrace us when we rebel or disappoint. Your mercy gives us the opportunity to try again, to return into your grace, to pick ourselves up and brush ourselves off. You forget how many strikes we have against us, but invite us back into the inheritance you desire for us. May our offering this day reflect our gratitude. In Christ we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
ask that these gifts be used to honor you and to glorify your holy name. Amen.
Valuable and gold, which though perishable, is refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, love him. Though not seeing him now, you believe in him, and you rejoice with inexpressible and glorious joy, because you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, Julia. I can tell Julia has better eyes than I did. Printed her Bible is so fine, I can't read it. The gospel lesson for today comes from the gospel according to St. John. I'll be reading from chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors were being opened where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and place my fingers in the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe." 8 days later, the disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. The doors were shut, but Jesus stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believe me." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not and yet believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that in believing, may have life in his name. This is the word of God to the people of God. On that very first Easter morning, only Mary Magdalene had seen the risen Christ. When she got to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away, she went and told Peter and John about it. Peter and John came running, and they believed. They believed that someone had indeed stolen Jesus' body. Then they went back where they were hiding. But Mary stayed at the tomb weeping. And it was there at the tomb that Jesus came to her, called her name, and she saw Jesus and believed. Jesus instructed Mary to go and tell the disciples what she had seen and heard. And Mary did what Jesus asked. She went and announced to his disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them what he had said to her. But apparently the disciples didn't believe Mary. Thomas has always gotten the bad rap for not believing. I think we're all in that same boat sometimes, aren't we? Unless we experience something for ourselves, we really don't tend to believe it. So that first Easter moved along. When evening came, the disciples were still hiding behind locked doors. We're told that they were filled with fear. They'd just seen what had happened to Jesus. They'd witnessed the horrors of Jesus' crucifixion, and they were scared out of their minds that these people would come and do the same to them. They didn't believe that Jesus had been raised from the dead. They believed that Jesus' body was missing. They still believed in a dead Jesus, not a resurrected Jesus. So they were terrified. And who could blame them? And then John tells us that Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then something very interesting happens. After Jesus shows the disciples the nail marks on his hands and his side, where the Romans pierced him with a spear, we're told that the disciples finally saw them. And then they were filled with joy. And then Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you." Could it be that in showing his wounds to the disciples, Jesus is not only showing them that he's the same person they saw hanging on the cross a few days ago, but also that the wounds proved to them that Jesus had overcome the worst thing that the world can do to him? If Jesus can be raised from the dead after having experienced a Roman execution, what else was there to fear? Jesus had overcome the worst that the world and the devil could do to him. Therefore, death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so Christ can say to the huddled and the scared disciples, "Peace be with you." Death is the one thing that people fear. I know most of you have heard this story about Rudyard Kipling's The Jungle Book, but I want to tell it again. Mowgli, the man cub, asked the animals what the most feared thing in the jungle is. And he told them when two animals meet on a narrow path that one of the animals must step aside and let the other animal pass. The animal that steps aside for no one would then be the most feared. And Mowgli wants to know what kind of animal that is. One tells him it's an elephant. Another tells him it's a lion. And finally, the wise old owl explains, "The most feared thing in the jungle is death. It steps aside for no one." The disciples in Jesus' time lived in a violent society. And we live in a violent society today. The whole world is violent. There seems to be wars about every corner. We see terrorists blowing up buildings, killing civilians in seemingly safe places. We see attacks on train stations, churches, hotels, streets. We see crazy people with guns walking into schools and places of business, shooting anyone that happens to be in the line of fire. So the anxiety level is high. The fear level is high. Jesus said to the first disciples, "Peace be with you." And Jesus says to us, "Peace be with you." Who wouldn't want peace? Isn't that what most of us desire the most? We all need peace, don't we? So how can we find it? How can we have peace? On the night before Jesus died in agony, he knew what he was facing. And yet he still took time to comfort his disciples with the message of peace. In John 14, 27, Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not be troubled and do not be afraid." So what does Jesus mean by this? How can we live in a world with all the violence, disasters, and death that goes on and be at peace? Certainly the kind of peace that Jesus promises and gives is not about living without troubles in our lives. It has nothing to do with our circumstances. It is something that's still with us, no matter what happens on the outside. We may be in the midst of terrible troubles and still have the peace that Jesus gives. Paul said he learned the secret to how to be content in any circumstance, whether being full or hungry, whether having plenty or being poor. And in Philippians 4:7, Paul talks about the peace of God that exceeds all understanding, that keeps our hearts and minds safe in Jesus Christ. Don't you want your heart and mind safe? That's a beautiful thought, isn't it? Again, the peace that Jesus offers us has nothing to do with tranquility, harmony, easy living. Instead, we're told that Jesus said to the disciples, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, I am sending you." What he's saying is, "Peace be with you. Now go and do what I did." And that very thing that he tells the disciples to do is what got him arrested, got him killed. And this only works through the power of the Holy Spirit. After Jesus said, "Peace be with you, as the Father sends me, I'm sending you," he breathed on the disciples, the Holy Spirit. So Jesus doesn't ask the disciples or ask us to conquer our fear on our own, but he breathes on us the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Holy Spirit is the presence of Christ in our lives. Jesus calls us to the same kind of peacemaking that led him to the cross. And this kind of peacemaking is only possible through the power of the Holy Spirit. Think about it. Jesus didn't come into this world to merely keep the status quo. Instead, Jesus' peace brings the outcast, the marginalized people, back into the fold and turned the way that the world thinks on its ear. The first shall be last. The greatest shall be the servant. So it's through following Jesus that we find true peace, a peace that transcends all understanding. It's been said that by ourselves, humans are not capable of following Jesus. Our sin is simply too great. By ourselves, we want to fit in. We want to maintain our social status. We want to have privilege. We want to keep our good name. And God knows this. And so, Jesus gives to those who will believe and receive it the gift of the Holy Spirit. And this Holy Spirit is Jesus' Spirit, God's Spirit. Just as God breathed into the nostrils of a human-shaped piece of clay in Genesis and made a living human being, so Jesus, having risen from the dead, breathes into our nostrils the breath of life. And when that happens, we become children of God. Children born not from blood, nor from human desire or passion, but born from God. In Matthew chapter 5, 9, Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God." So there is a correlation between having peace and making peace. There's a correlation between following Jesus and having peace. There's a correlation between dying to self and living for God and neighbor and having peace. There's a correlation between being born of the Spirit and having peace. A correlation between working for inclusion of the ostracized, loving our enemies, seeking justice for the oppressed, the rejected, the harassed, and having a peace which transcends all understanding. As one person has said, Jesus' peace invites the lion to see the lamb as a neighbor and a friend, the Jew to speak with the Samaritan, and the prostitute to dine with the Pharisee. This is a new way of living. A new way of living in this world. It's a kingdom way of living. It's the Jesus way of living. And it's the only way that leads to peace. In the eyes of the world, it may not make any sense. Jesus' peace doesn't aim guns at one another. Jesus' peace doesn't say an eye for an eye. Jesus' peace doesn't seek revenge. Jesus' peace makes disciples and fills those who experience it with joy. I'll leave you with this question. Do you have the peace of Jesus Christ? Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you praise for your abundant mercy and the grace that we receive from you. We thank you for your faithfulness, even though we're not always faithful to you. Lord Jesus, we ask you to give us peace in our mind, body, soul, and spirit. and make our enemies be at peace with us. Let your peace reign in our family, in our place of work, business, and everything we lay our hands on. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. And now let us pray together the model prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now I'd ask if you would please stand with me as we affirm our faith by turning to page 881 in your hymnal, The Apostles' Creed. Together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.